Thank you. Hello, everybody. In the next 20 or so minutes, I'd like to take you all on a brief history of financial malware or banking Trojans. And I'd like to take you past some of the most important events and decisions that helped shape the financial malware developments over the past 10 years, and that brought us to where we are today with regards to banking Trojans. And where are we today with the banking Trojans? Well, this slide is our attempt at putting together a financial malware family tree, divided into three main sections, either kit malware, malware which you buy, malware which you rent as malware as a service, and finally private malware, which is used by the same group that developed them for their own exclusive use. Now, this is the current state of the malware landscape, and in the next 20 or so minutes, we're going to take a little history of how it came to be and what the events that shaped this malware tree. Before we do that, let's take a couple of minutes to define what is financial malware. Financial malware or banking Trojans are malware families that are used by attackers to manipulate online banking sessions, be it commercial or retail. Most financial malware is a man-in-the-browser variant. It will hook the browser to allow the attacker to manipulate the traffic that's sent between the financial organization and the victim. They hook the browser because that's the place where they can bypass the SSL protection that would normally prevent you from tampering with that traffic. Most financial malware, besides doing man in the browser, also forms botnets. It will report back to a central command and control server, allowing the attackers to direct the attack. The whole development basically started in 2004, and the period between 2004 and 2007 can be characterized as roll your own. This is when the first families appeared, and when attackers and developers were trying to figure out how to run these types of attacks. Names like Bankpatch, Hackstore, A3111Death, Limbo, or NetHell. Now, back in those days, it was very rudimentary, and to be able to run a successful attack, you had to be pretty good technically. You had to be able to develop and write code. If you talk to the old hands in this industry, at the mention of these names, they all get very misty-eyed, and they think back to those very nice early days when all of this was exciting and new, and we were chasing after Bankpatch or NetHell. But all of that changed. And the big change came in 2006 with the appearance of the first real cybercrime kit. Now, a cybercrime kit made it much easier to run these attacks. People or criminals who weren't expert developers could now launch their own attacks. ZeuS was the first one to appear. It is the original cybercrime kit, written by an author who goes and went by the name of Slavic. And shortly after its appearance, it started to gain real traction and become very popular. Slavic sold ZeuS as a kit. You could buy it on the underground, and then you'd have to set it up and run it yourself. Now, because it became very popular, this led to other people noticing this and deciding that maybe they wanted a piece of this market share. The next major development came in 2009 when SpyEye enters the stage. Now, the author of SpyEye, a gentleman by the name of Gribodemon, brought out SpyEye specifically to steal away market share from ZeuS. And he took a couple of business decisions that enabled him or made it easier to steal market share from ZeuS. The first thing is he undercut ZeuS on price. Whereas a typical ZeuS kit with all full options retailed for about $8,000, SpyEye was only $1,000. The second thing he did was to make the cost of switching for existing ZeuS customers very low. He did that by adopting the ZeuS config style. That meant that any existing attack that you were running off of a ZeuS botnet, you could switch over to SpyEye without having to modify it at all. This meant that the cost of switching was very low. That all sounds very good. The only small downside was that the first versions of SpyEye were absolutely terrible. Any machine you tried to infect would probably blue screen itself to death and never boot up again. But Gribodemon had a rapid pace of development, and the first version after the first versions, SpyEye started to quickly improve. And then a battle ensued for market share. They were trying to take market share away from each other. Now, thinking about that, you would think that, as we've been talking about SpyEye and ZeuS, that at that point in time, SpyEye and ZeuS were the only two malware families in town. That wasn't so. They were the most popular. They were helping to shape the market. But there were others. And I want to go at two of them because they contain very interesting lessons. The first is Garberp. Garberp was another form of kit malware written by Russian authors who sold it, but also used it themselves, initially to target banks in Northern Europe. But later on, they also started targeting banks in Russia itself. And through that, they learned a very important lesson. The lesson here is do not attack banks in the country that you reside in, because then the law enforcement operation to catch you changes from an international one to a domestic operation. And that's far easier and far more likely to be successful. And in the case of Garberp, that turned out to be the case as well. In 2012, in a number of Dawn raids, the Russian police arrested most of the key members. And here is one of them, sitting on the floor after having been rudely awakened by the Russian police. Was this the end of Garberp? No, as we'll see later on, Garberp came back. It principally because, although some of the members of the gang were sent to jail, others were either not arrested or made bail shortly after their arrest and promptly fled Russia. Another very interesting malware group was Cinewall, or Torpig. Cinewall was a closed group. They actually were around for a very long time, started in 2006 and went up right until 2013. What's interesting about Cinewall is not only were they closed, but they are the one that got away. Because Cinewall was a closed group, nobody ever really figured out who they were or the identities behind the actors involved with Cinewall. And before anybody had a chance to figure that out, in 2013, they simply packed up everything and disappeared. And nobody's ever really been able to figure out who was behind Cinewall. And as you'll see in the rest of the story, that is unusual. Quite a lot of these actors have a tendency to keep going just that little bit too long and run afoul of law enforcement at some point. With the appearance of all this kit malware, and as we've been focusing on that malware, an entire ecosystem at the same time was springing up around online banking attacks. Malware is one part of the equation. This slide shows you the steps involved in running a successful online banking attack. And for each of these steps, a variety of underground products and services sprung up. They still exist today, which would help you set up, run, and maintain a successful attack. So back to our market battle between SpyEye and ZeuS. In 2010, something very peculiar happened. ZeuS development was slowing down. ZeuS was at version 2.0.8.9. There hadn't been many updates for quite some time. and then suddenly something very peculiar happened. Slavik, the author of ZeuS, appeared in an underground forum and announced that he was ceasing development of ZeuS and that he was actually handing over the entire source code to his main competitor, Gribodemon, who was, of course, very happy to receive this free gift. Now, that's very unusual. Why would someone give away a very profitable business for free to his main competitor? Well, it turned out that the reality was slightly more complicated than it first appeared. Ever since Slavik had been writing ZeuS, he had not only been selling it in the underground as a kit malware, but he was also part of a crew called the Jabbersoos crew, which used ZeuS to go after high-value commercial accounts. His role in that gang was simply to supply the software and set up and maintain the infrastructure around it. and Slavik had come to a realization. He suddenly realized that he was making far more money being a member of the Jabbersoos crew and supplying them with software as a service than he was selling his malware in kit form. More so, selling kit malware is a hassle. You need to support your customers. You also have the problem of piracy. People are stealing your software. Thieves stealing from thieves. Who would have thought that? And also, you're very public. You're a very public figure. You draw a big target for law enforcement on your back because you're the guy who's supplying all these criminals with one of the key things they need to execute their crimes. So law enforcement will soon zoom in on you. So he decided that he wanted to be rid of the whole kit business. And what he did was very clever, because by giving it all to Gribodemon for free, all the attention switched to Gribodemon, and he was free, he had his hands free to continue developing ZeuS further, but in this case, instead of selling it, only delivering it to the Jabber ZeuS crew. Now, he kept on developing ZeuS. He started on the next version, and that morphed into peer-to-peer ZeuS, or game-over ZeuS. And as you'll see later on, that became very popular indeed. The Jabber ZeuS crew kept on using it, and they changed, they changed their name. We started calling them the game-over ZeuS crew from then on, because that was the malware they were using. Now, as it turns out, Slavik had not only given the source code to Gribodemon, but to some of his bigger customers as well, basically to, because they might not want to do business with Gribodemon. So instead, to appease them, he'd given them the source code as well. Well, it turned out that at least one of those customers wasn't entirely trustworthy, because early in 2011, the entire ZeuS source code leaked onto the internet. And that caused a major upset, because now anybody could download that source code, compile it, and start using it. In effect, it made financial malware or banking trojans free. But not only could you could you start using it, you could also start developing it. You start changing it and modifying it. And lots of people tried their hand at that. Some of these variants were very short-lived, but others turned into products in their own right. And on our malware family tree, over on the right in the orange section, you see a huge branch out from the ZeuS source code. Products like Ice9, Citadel, and Kins became malware families in their own right. Some of them became very popular, and some of them even exist to this day. And all of them trace their lineage back to this leak of the ZeuS source code. So what happened to SpyEye in the meantime? Well, ever since Slavik gave the source code to Gribodemon, everybody was expecting Gribodemon to come up with a spy ZeuS, combine the best of the best of both worlds, roll the two source codes into one, and create a super Trojan. He never did. As a matter of fact, after the leak of the ZeuS source code, he kind of lost interest as well. More than that, he figured out what Slavik had actually done, and then basically did the same. He ceased development of SpyEye, and he started developing a new version, which he called SpyEye 2, and which would only be available as a managed service. He, too, was going down the managed malware route. He didn't get very long to profit from that, because in 2013, he decided that he'd earned a holiday, and so he took a holiday to Costa Rica. What Gribodemon didn't know was that the FBI had figured out who he was, and so when he got off the plane in Costa Rica, he was promptly arrested and extradited to the US to face trial, and that was the end of SpyEye. Now, this left as our main player peer-to-peer ZeuS, and the period of 2011 to 2014 were the heyday of peer-to-peer ZeuS. Peer-to-peer ZeuS was immensely popular. Remember, the peer-to-peer ZeuS crew themselves kept using it to go after commercial banking and high-value accounts, but also lots of other groups rented space on the peer-to-peer ZeuS infrastructure to run their own attacks. Peer-to-peer ZeuS was basically active all over the world. Wherever you were, you would find a peer-to-peer ZeuS botnet running attacks. That also meant that law enforcement was very interested in taking it down. However, Slavik had built a very robust platform, and it was very difficult to take it down. Not only that, but peer-to-peer ZeuS was branching out. Besides doing online banking attacks, they had also developed a strain of ransomware called CryptoLocker, which they were using to monetize victims in other and new ways. However, despite this being difficult, in 2014, after an operation or an investigation that lasted many years and involved international law enforcement, security company, companies, academia, and researchers, in an international coordinated effort, peer-to-peer ZeuS was taken down. But not only was peer-to-peer ZeuS taken down, Slavik's real identity became known. The FBI put him on their most wanted list, and we all learned that the man who'd been around ever since 2006, and everybody had always known as Slavik, was actually called Yevgeny Mikhailovich Bogachev. And in February of this year, the US State Department added their two pennies to the hat and came out, offered a reward for $3 million if anyone who can come up and give them the information that will lead to Slavik's arrest. He's currently still at large in Russia. So with the demise of peer-to-peer ZeuS, we actually come to the present day. Peer-to-peer ZeuS may have gone around this time last year, but peer-to-peer ZeuS customers still are around and want to run attacks. So at least two groups of customers have decided to run their own, to build and run their own platforms. These are two malware families that are currently making the news, Dyer and Drydex. And remember Carberp, our gentleman in his underpants? Well, they're back as well. They've morphed, they've changed. Carberp is now called Anunnak, and they're using that same software in new ways, and in two different ways. In the US and in Europe, they're using Anunnak to go after retailers and point-of-sale terminals specifically, stealing credit card data. In Russia, they're using Anunnak to target banks directly. As you may have gathered from this, they certainly haven't given up on targeting Russia directly. The going after point-of-sale terminals is a new tactic that the actors in this space have adopted en masse. It's a very big interest from criminal actors who used to be involved with online banking attacks in going after point-of-sale systems. Ever since the Target hack, they have woken up to the fact that there's good money, a lot of money to be made stealing credit card data. Another thing that they've all woken up to, thanks to the peer-to-peer ZeuS, is that ransomware is also another good way to earn money. And after the peer-to-peer ZeuS takedown and the demise of the CryptoLocker ransomware, we're seeing a lot of copycat malware, copycat ransomware, deploying or employing those same tactics. So with that, we come to the end of our very brief overview of historical malware. What should you take away from these 20 minutes? I think the takeaways are on a couple of levels. The first is on the subject being discussed. Financial malware, banking Trojans today are much more sophisticated than they were back in 2004. The attacks being launched today are much more sophisticated. The actors are better organized and also branching out into new areas, point of sale, ransomware. What I hope you've also seen is that these types of threats don't appear out of nowhere. They evolve and over a longer period before they kind of pop up on the radar. And looking back at our malware map at the beginning, I hope that now that you know the rest of this story, the map makes a little more sense. When you have more context around these types of threats, you start to understand them better. And the final takeaway is that even though the subject of this talk was supposed to be all about malware, we've actually spent most of our time talking about the actors behind the malware. So to understand malware and to understand threats, you should look beyond the malware, look at the actors developing and running these attacks. Thank you very much.